Why did Paul say, I need to impart some spiritual gift to you? Many Christians say, I remember when someone laid hands on me to receive the gift of healing. I started praying for the sick and they were getting healed. Paul said to the Roman church, I long to see you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end you may be established. Romans 1, verse 11. The truth is, many Christians, even after you have given them the Bible studies on the perfect redemption plan of God, will not believe it. They will still think that the Holy Spirit who moved into them is incomplete. He came empty-handed when he moved into them. No matter how much you tell them you are no different than them, they have the same Holy Spirit in them who came with all his gifts. They have the same Jesus who is complete in them, and they have received the same anointing of the Holy Spirit when they received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and power. What they just need to do is to fear God and practice righteousness, and they will be able to flow effortlessly in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. They still say within themselves, I will have the manifestations of that particular gift of the Spirit when that minister lays his hands on me. And that is what will work for them because they have faith in that method of receiving the gifts of the Spirit. Just like we have seen with healing, God uses laying on of hands, prayer cloths, Holy Communion, oil, and the spoken word to heal. It is a sick person who chooses how he wants to be healed. God just wants to see that person healed, that is all. But if that person believes that he has the spirit of life in him and he can command healing to his own body, then he will be healed. It is the same thing with impartation of the gifts of the Spirit listed in 1 Corinthians 12. Paul tells us, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 4. All those gifts come from the same Holy Spirit, and He is in you. God wants the church to realize that they have all the gifts of the Spirit in them, for the Spirit of God came fully in them. Jesus tells us, I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another Comforter, that He may abide with you forever. John 14, verse 16. So the Holy Spirit abides with you forever. There is never a time that he leaves you to go back to heaven to get another gift of the Spirit to bring back to you. He came with all of them and he never leaves you forever. God is so good and wants all of us to have the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit so that we can be effective in the kingdom of God. So he tells us, what will it take for you to believe my word? Some will say, if it is written, I believe it is for me and I walk in it. That is the kind of faith God wants us to have. Some will say, Lord, I know it is written, yet I do not truly believe it is for me, but if you send someone to speak to me, I will believe it. So God says, fine. And he sends someone to you to speak the word of God to you, and because you heard that written word spoken to you have faith and receive it. Romans 10, verse 17. Some will say, Lord, I know it is written, and you send someone to speak to me, but if only that person lays hands on me, or pours oil, which is a symbol of the anointing of the Holy Spirit on me, then I will receive it. God says, fine. And he sends a person to pour oil on you or lay hands on you. In a way, we are fleecing God like Gideon did before believing the word of God. Judges 6. Is God mad at us when we fleece him, meaning we ask for signs before believing what he says about us? The answer is no. It is not God's ideal. The ideal is that we believe first. Yet God is not mad at us if we have not reached that level of faith yet. As we grow into the measure of the full stature of Christ, we will be fleecing God less and less, but take him at his words, even his written word. God wants us to so believe him that sometimes he even asks us to ask him for a sign that will help us believe his word and that he will back us up when we step out in faith to do what he has called us to do. The Lord spoke again unto Ahaz, saying, Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Ask it either in the depths or in the height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he, the prophet Isaiah, said, Hear now, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Isaiah 7, verse 10 to 14. Should we stay in the baby stage of our faith all our life, where we fleece God all the time? The answer is no. Is it a small thing for you to weary men, but will you weary my God also? None of us will be happy if his son, who is 20 years old, still acts like a 2-year-old child. You will be weary of such behavior. I, Jerry, have not arrived yet. I am still growing into the measure of the full stature of Christ Jesus. God had given a prophecy through the mouth of his prophet Isaiah to King Ahaz concerning his enemies, the Syrians, and the kingdom of Israel under the leadership of the Ephraimites, that within 60 years Ephraim would be broken, and they would no longer be a people. King Ahaz of Judah had trouble believing the prophecy, Isaiah 7, verse 1 to 9. So God wanted to help his faith, so the prophet Isaiah asked King Ahaz to ask God for a sign, so that he would believe that God would perform his word through the mouth of Isaiah. But the king thought he was tempting the Lord by so doing. And God gave him a sign, even a prophecy of the virgin birth of Jesus. Also, in Isaiah 38, King Hezekiah of Judah was sick and near to death. Initially, the prophet Isaiah came and told him that he would not recover from his sickness, so he should set his house in order, for he was going to die. After Hezekiah had pleaded his case before the Lord sent the same Isaiah to go and tell him that he would live and God had added 15 more years to his life. But Hezekiah was a bit confused, for he had received 2 different prophecies from the same Isaiah. Which one should he believe? Of course he wanted to believe the second one that said he would live and not die, to declare the works of the Lord. Psalm 118, verse 17. Then came the word of the Lord to Isaiah, saying, Go, and say to Hezekiah, Thus says the Lord, the God of David your father, I have heard your prayer, I have seen your tears. Behold, I will add unto your days 15 years, and I will deliver you and the city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend the city. And this shall be a sign unto you from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he has spoken. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees, which is gone down in the sundial of Ahaz, 10 degrees backward. So the sun returned 10 degrees, by which degrees it was gone down. Isaiah 38, verse 4-8. So God himself gave a sign to King Hezekiah, that not only would he be healed of his terminal illness, but also when he was healed, God would also deliver him and his city from their enemies, the Assyrians. In the New Testament, we see Jesus using the boat of Peter for preaching in Luke 5. When he finished preaching, he instructed them to launch out into the deep and let down their nets for a catch, though they had toiled all night and caught nothing. They obeyed Jesus' command and had a miraculous catch of fish. In John 21, after the resurrection of Jesus, the disciples were discouraged, for Jesus was no longer with them physically. They thought they would be worse off since Jesus would physically go away, and they did not believe what Jesus said, that it is to their advantage that he goes away so that he can send them the Holy Spirit. John 16, verse 7. They thought that they needed to go back to their former occupation to provide for their families. So Peter said, "I'm going fishing." And six other disciples said, "We are going with you." But they caught nothing all night. In the morning, Jesus was standing at the shore of the sea broiling fish. He said to them, "Children, have you caught anything?" They said, "Nothing." He instructed them to cast their net on the right side of the boat, and they shall find fish. When John saw the miraculous catch of fish, it reminded him of the sign of Luke 5, when they were in a similar situation, and when they obeyed the instruction of the Lord, they had a miraculous catch of fish. John said to Peter, "It is the Lord." How did John know it was the Lord? By the sign Jesus gave them. In Luke 5, after Jesus had demonstrated he could provide for them and their families, he said to them, "Follow me." And in John 21, he came to reassure them and each one of us that even if he is no longer with us physically, he still provides for us through the Holy Spirit, just like when he was with them physically. I remember in January 2015, I had to go to London to meet a church leader face to face and tell him that the Lord told me to no longer serve under their ministry. I remember I was afraid to go. The Lord had been telling me to come out of that ministry since June 2014. I was afraid of stepping into the unknown, for the people had been good to me, and they had become a family to me. And I have truly learned a lot being under that noble ministry. The Lord told me, "You will not enter 2015 with that ministry." So, on the 12th of January 2015, I remember the Lord told me I must go to London. My bank account was empty until 8 p.m. on the 11th of January 2015. I said to God, "If you want me to go to London, then you must put the money into my account to buy the ticket tonight." I knew and hoped that there was no money, so I was safe. I could not go to London. But at 11 p.m. the Lord told me, "Go on to the internet and buy a return ticket to London for the first coach early in the morning. I have put money into your account." I went online and bought the ticket, and the transaction was approved by my bank. So I knew it was the Lord, and when I arrived in London, the leader said to me it is the first time that he had come to his office in 2015, and it was the first time that he had come to his office on a Tuesday. I knew God's hand was in it. God knew he would be there. These people had been so good to me, and I say that from the bottom of my heart. They have added value, character, integrity, and maturity to me. I was a fool when they allowed me to serve under their ministry, for foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. But now I have some wisdom through the rod of correction of the Word of God they deposited in my life. Proverbs 22 verse 15. They believed in me and trusted God to prune me so that I could bear much fruit. Many would have said, "Young men easily fall into sexual immoralities. If we allow him to serve under our ministry, since he is not married yet, he might fall into sexual sin and bring disrepute to our noble ministry." Yet they took an enormous leap of faith and trust and allowed this young man, who was not yet married, to serve under their ministry. I used to pray to God and still do, saying, "God, never let me fall into sexual immoralities, financial manipulation, and scandal, and into heresy." And anybody who loves me should always pray for me in these three aspects. Of course, working with people at times, there are disagreements and misunderstandings, and offence is bound to happen. Luke 17 verse 1. I have offended many, for foolishness was bound in my earthen vessel, and some also have offended me. Yet we always ought to remember that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7. Let us not stumble at the earthen vessel, but focus on the treasure God deposited in people. The reason why the Lord told me to come out is because he wanted me to start a new work for him and make disciples, teaching them using my weekly milk Bible studies he had instructed me to write. And on the 12th of January 2015, after I had finished my meeting with that leader in London, I found a church that was open and I went to pray. God gave me Psalm 71 and the book of Hosea, and of course Isaiah 56 verse 7. He said, "Go, heal the backsliding of my people, build me a house of prayer for all nations, make disciples of all nations, teach them what I have taught you from your youth, and every house must become a house of prayer for all nations." The Lord said many other things, but I am not allowed to share them in these Bible studies. Jesus said, "According to your faith or belief, be it unto you." Matthew 9, verse 29. For instance, Jesus spat on the ground and made clay with his spittle and rubbed it on the eyes of a blind man and said to him, "Go, wash at the pool called Siloam." After the man did it, he received his sight. John 9, verse 6 to 7. Many of us do not understand why Jesus did it, and we will be offended by that. It is degrading. But in those days, it was not. Why? Because in the medical system back then, they believed that spittle had some medicinal powers. So when Jesus spat on him, the blind man believed he was healed. It was done to him according to his faith. The second reason Jesus made clay and anointed his eyes was to demonstrate that God created mankind out of the dust of the earth, as Genesis 2, verse 7 tells us. The day is coming, and now is, when a minister of reconciliation will take dust from the ground and spit on it and anoint the amputated arms and amputated legs and command them to be created. Thus, in front of all the cameras of the world, that minister of reconciliation demonstrates at will to the world that Jesus Christ created mankind from the dust of the earth. It was not the theory of evolution or the Big Bang theory, but it was Jesus Christ. John 1 verse 3 to 7. In that day, trees also grow at will in front of all the cameras of the world to demonstrate that God also created the planet Earth, as Genesis 1:11 and Jonah 4:6 tells us, for everything was created by him, for him, and through him. Colossians 1 verse 16. The woman, who had the issue of blood for 12 years, said to herself, "If only I can touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed." And after she did, she was healed. Matthew 9, verse 20 to 22. Jesus said to her, "Daughter, be of good comfort. Your faith has made you whole." God truly wants us to enjoy everything Jesus died for. And how we get it and enjoy it is up to us, according to our belief. Many people are looking for a method. It is not a method, it is just your belief. The Jewish leaders asked the blind man who received his sight after Jesus spat on him, "How were your eyes opened?" He explained to them, but they did not believe. Then they said to him again, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you did not hear. Wherefore would you hear it again? Will you also be his disciples?" John 9, verse 25 to 27. Those Jewish leaders did not like Jesus, but they liked the miracles he performed. They were envious, so deep inside them, they might have said, "We have spat on many people, and they were not healed. Many people have touched the hem of our garment, but they were not healed. How does this Jesus do it?" Many Christians are still asking the same questions. The method does not matter. You have the Spirit of God in you, and he is complete in you. God heals people according to your belief, you who minister to them, and according to the belief of the people. But God wants us to be like Jesus. Jesus did not have to wait for someone to speak to him or even God to speak to him, though God always speaks with him and people spoke to him. As far as Jesus was concerned, if something is written in the Word of God, he believes it is for him. He always refers people to the written Word of God, and we should do like Jesus. Over and over he says, "It is written, it is written, it is written." Did God speak to him? The answer is yes. Did people prophesy over him? The answer is yes. Simeon did. Luke 2 verse 24 to 32. But Jesus acted on the written word of God. The prophecy people gave to Jesus was always lining up with what was already written about him anyway. He said, "I come in the volume of the book, and it is written of me to do your will, O God." Hebrews 10 verse 7. People of God will prophesy over your life. It'll lift you up. But what they are saying is already written about you in the Bible. Why not read it, believe it, and act on it? So the Roman brethren, even after all the teaching of what God had done for them and who they were in Christ, were not walking in some of the gifts of the Spirit. So Paul writes to them, when he comes there, he will impart those gifts to them, either by laying on of his hands, or by speaking a word over them, or by anointing them with oil or any other method they have faith in. They will receive the manifestations of those gifts. It'll be done to them according to their faith. On the day of Pentecost, in Acts 2, the Holy Spirit came upon all who were in the upper room, and they manifested the gift of tongues, which is one of the gifts of the Spirit, and they also prophesied. Prophecy is another gift of the Spirit. Nobody laid hands on them. In Acts 10, Peter goes in the house of Cornelius. When he speaks the word of God to them, they believe, and the Holy Spirit fell on them, and they spoke in tongues, and they prophesied. Peter never laid hands on them to impart the gift of tongues and the gift of prophecy. What they received was the impartation of the word of God, and once they believed the word of God out of the mouth of Peter, they received the gifts of the Spirit. The impartation of the word of God is the best way, for the words that we speak are spirit and life. John 6 verse 63. When Paul came to Ephesus, he met Apollos and other disciples who were followers of John the Baptist, but now had believed in Jesus. They had not received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of the gift of tongues and the gift of prophecy, Acts 19. When Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied, Acts 19 verse 6. They manifested two gifts of the Spirit, tongues and prophecy. Paul first of all imparted the word of God to them. What is the meaning of the baptism of the Spirit and fire, why we need it, and then he laid hands on them as a point of contact, and since they believed both the word and the method, they received it. When Paul writes to the Romans that he wants to impart some spiritual gifts to them, the first thing that he did was to impart the revelation of the Word of God. If some believed it, like Cornelius and the people in his house did, they would not even need the hands of Paul laid on them, but some thought they would only receive it after Paul had laid his hands on them. It was done to them according to their belief. Paul always wants people to know what God has done for them by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, who he is now in them, and who they are in Christ. Paul explains that it is the same Holy Spirit he has, that they have. Everything he has, they have also. One of the reasons he wants them to receive things directly from God without someone laying hands on them is because some people will try to take advantage or even abuse them. They will be saying, "I am the one who imparted that gift to you. I am the one who blessed you when I laid my hands on you. I am the one who ordained you into ministry," and they will use it to keep you in bondage. But when you know who you are, you know that it is God who appointed and ordained you. It is God who blessed you. Everything you've received is from God. Jesus is the one who prayed the Father for you to receive the Holy Ghost. As it is written, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you for ever, even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you, and shall be in you. John 14, verse 16 to 17. On the day of Pentecost in Acts 2, the disciples believed the prayer of Jesus and did not need his physical hands laid on them, yet they all received the impartation of the gifts of the Spirit. My prayer is that you and I will only believe the written word of God. If you want someone to lay hands on you to impart some spiritual blessing or spiritual gifts, you must know the person. Let it be your apostle, your prophet, your evangelist, your teacher, your pastor, or any born-again believer whose lifestyle you personally know. Paul says, If I be not an apostle to others, yet doubtless I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 2. Even if they lay hands on you, and because you believe, you start manifesting those gifts of the Spirit, you must get the understanding that you did not get it from them per se, but from the Holy Ghost. They were just vessels God used to help you believe his promises are also for you. Get the best impartation, which is the impartation of the Word, and act on the Word, what it says about you, because if you believe in your heart that person is the source of your gifts or blessings, you will never rise above them, because it is a second-hand gift. You must understand it is the Holy Ghost in you, and you do not have second-hand gifts of the Spirit, nor a second-hand anointing. Having said that, we should not despise the earthen vessel God uses to bring us the manifestations of the Spirit of God and the demonstration of the power of God. As we have explained, that for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to flow effortlessly, it takes the cooperation of the earthen vessel, even the yieldingness of the earthen vessel. We have seen that the vessel must be grafted onto the olive tree of the triune God. He should not just have leaves, which talk about our profession or confession of faith, but he should be a partaker of the root, even the holiness of God the Father. If he wants to partake of the fatness or anointing of the Holy Spirit, he should bear the fruit of the Spirit, even more fruit of the Spirit. Christ Jesus, who is the seed of Abraham, must be formed in him. He should have the revelation of the Word of God, and he should have a lifestyle of prayer with fasting. The Apostle said, We will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. Acts 6 verse 4. Paul tells us, Remember those who lead or rule over you, who have spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, considering the outcome of their conduct. Hebrews 13 verse 7. Obey those who lead or rule over you and be submissive, as long as what they are asking you to do accords with the general counsel of the Holy Scriptures, because they watch out for your souls as those who must give account to God. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you. Hebrews 13 verse 17. I have worked with a dear brother in 2014 who wanted to learn divine healing. So he would bring me sick people and I prayed for them and they were healed and delivered. I took sometimes up to 6 hours of my time every week to explain the scriptures to him, but he was disrespectful and verbally abusive toward me, especially when I addressed the issue of holiness and the fruit of the Spirit. And he would pray for the sick and shout at demons in the name of Jesus, and nothing would happen. I told him, Maybe you ought to embrace the sanctified life of Jesus, his way and his truth, in order to be a partaker of his anointing. He did not want to hear the truth. I said to him, I, Jerry, chose a particular lifestyle to be able to flow in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. I know even the willingness and the ability to choose that lifestyle was given to me by God. Philippians 2 verse 13. Yet I was willing to yield to the Holy Spirit and the written word of God. God does not take me for granted. Paul tells me God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. Hebrews 6 verse 10. You should not take me for granted either by treating me disrespectfully when I have not been disrespectful toward you. You go and do the same thing Jesus requires for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to flow through you, for I will not work any longer with you. If there is no mutual respect and honor, discipleship cannot work. I respect you and honor you. You ought to reciprocate. He crossed the line when he said that I was of the devil, and maybe I was casting out devils by demonic powers. I said to him, now you are blaspheming against the Holy Spirit. Yet he wanted me to go and heal the sick people he knew. I said, I will no longer go with you. Let the Jesus Christ whom you are serving heal your sick people, since you accuse me of healing and delivering people by a demonic power. You do not need my help. People who accused Jesus of casting out demons by Beelzebub were not his disciples, and Jesus did not waste his precious time with them. Even in his hometown, people who were offended at him and did not bring their sick people, Jesus did not say, they do not believe in me, they are offended at me, they even think I have Beelzebub in me, and they are not willing to come to me. I will go into their houses and heal them by force. Nowhere in the Bible had Jesus or the prophets done that. Paul said to Titus, warn a divisive person or heretics, a person who holds and teaches opinions repugnant to the established faith, once, and then warn them a second time. After that, have nothing to do with them. Titus 3 verse 10. I used to wonder why the evangelist Jack Coe used to say there are two categories of people he does not waste much of his time trying to explain spiritual truths to. In the first category we have the agnostic, someone who neither believes nor disbelieves in the existence of God, and the atheist, someone who believes that God or gods, which are but demons, are man-made constructs, myths, and legends. They are of the devil and are going to hell. Tell them the truth of the word of God once and twice, but do not waste your time explaining over and over things to them. The number of hours you waste with them, you could have won 100 souls to Christ. The second category of people is the born-again Christians who hold on to the tradition of their founding fathers of their church or ministry and reject the truth of the written word of God. Even after you have demonstrated the truth from the scriptures, they still reject it. It has happened to me with people who came from other ministries who hated holiness and who believed once saved, always saved. Some of them even went to the extent of telling the people to reject the whole Old Testament, reject all the four Gospels, reject all the other apostles of Jesus, and only read the letters of Paul. And even after I had shown them from the letters of Paul the doctrine of holiness, they still rejected it. I wasted 1 year trying to make those people change and embrace the doctrine of holiness. Then the Lord brought to my remembrance a scripture of Paul to Titus. Warn a divisive person or heretic, a person who holds and teaches opinions repugnant to the established faith, once, and then warn them a second time. After that, have nothing to do with them. Titus 3 verse 10. Paul said to his disciple Timothy, until I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in you, which was given you by prophecy, with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery, body of elders in the Christian church. Meditate upon these things. Give yourself wholly to them, that your profiting or progress may appear to all. 1 Timothy 4, verse 13 to 15. But watch in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of your ministry. 2 Timothy 4, verse 5. Timothy was called by Jesus to be an evangelist. The elders in the church received the word of God and prophesied it over him, and they prayed for him by laying hands on him. But truly his call to be an evangelist was not the church and the elders of the church that gave him that, but Jesus. For Paul explains to us, Jesus himself, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Ephesians 4, verse 8 to 11. In Acts 13 also we have the elders of the church praying for Paul and Barnabas and laying hands on them to commission them into the apostleship to the Gentiles. As it is written, Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed, and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Acts 13, verse 1 to 3. So it was the Holy Ghost who called Paul and Barnabas in their apostleship, not the elders of the church. None of the elders or anybody in the church, including the apostles, died for you and ascended into heaven for you, so that they can give you a gift, and in this case one of the fivefold ministry gifts, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher. Jesus is the only one who died and ascended for you, and he is the one who gave you that office. Even if people have prophesied over your office and laid hands on you, it is Jesus who did it. Man should not take any credit for that. God said to Jeremiah, Before I formed you in the belly or in your mother's womb, I knew you. And before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified you, and I ordained you a prophet unto the nations. Jeremiah 1, verse 5. When people were trying to belittle the apostleship of Paul, he said the same thing God said to Jeremiah. But when it pleased God, who separated, sanctified me from my mother's womb, and called me by his grace to reveal his Son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I confirmed, not with flesh and blood. Galatians 1, verse 15 to 16. So even if people prophesy what your office is and lay hands on you like they did to Paul and Barnabas for their apostleship or to Timothy for his call of an evangelist, it is God deciding to reveal to you and the world around you what he has called you and ordained you for. Jeremiah was called and ordained a prophet unto the nations when he was still in his mother's womb. Paul was called and ordained an apostle to the Gentiles by Jesus in his mother's womb. Ephesians 1 verse 1, Romans 11 verse 13, and Galatians 1 verse 15 to 16. Timothy was called and ordained by Jesus an evangelist in his mother's womb too, so that no one can take the glory and say, I am the one who called you and ordained you. God did it all before you were even born, so that no one will steal his glory in your life. Jesus was the Christ in Mary's womb. That is why wise men from the east came to see the king who is born in Israel. Matthew 2. Though Simeon prophesied over the baby Jesus, he was only telling the world who God already said Jesus was. And when John the Baptist baptized Jesus, it was only a public time to reveal to the world who Jesus is from the very beginning. That is why Paul, when he was defending his apostleship, said, "But of those who seem to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it makes no matter to me. God is no respecter of persons, for they who seem to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me." Galatians 2, verse 6. You are complete in Christ, therefore desire the impartation of the word of God and of the life of the people who are following Jesus in spirit and in truth. Paul said, "We were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls or lives, because you were dear unto us." 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 8. Paul gave us the gospel and also his life experience, his emotions and thoughts when he faced difficulties and how he overcame them all, so that we can have the same thing he had. We have the same Holy Ghost in us, the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon us, the same Jesus and the same God the Father in us. We are complete in Jesus. We have received the same power of the Holy Ghost or the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon us when we received the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire with evidence of speaking in tongues.